Our Bible passage this morning is from Luke chapter 2, page 1027. And what we're doing these next couple of weeks is really just an excuse to have a close look at Luke chapter 2 and some ideas that flow their way through Luke's gospel. So if you'd open up Luke chapter 2, page 1027. As you do that, just a final reminder from me about our Christmas appeal. If you've got kids, hopefully they've built their little money boxes at home and they're filling them up. But really the money boxes are just a small part of the appeal. We're looking for considerable amount of money to help build cement brick homes in the refugee camp in northern Iraq. And as you've heard, Tim Buxton, who's working over there, God willing, will be safely back here with us next weekend to tell us firsthand about what's going on. And that will be a great encouragement to us and hopefully to the Buxtons too. We're in Luke chapter 2, page 1027, and I want to draw your eye right down to the bottom of the left-hand column, verse 22 of Luke chapter 2, under the heading, Jesus presented in the temple. When the time came for the purification rites required by the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary took Jesus to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. Now, there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel." The child's father and mother marvelled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Penuel of the tribe of Asher. She was very old. She'd lived with her husband 7 years after a marriage, and then was a widow until she was 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped night and day, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. When Joseph and Mary had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong. He was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was on him. Can I encourage you to keep your Bibles open there and just tune in, keep looking at the passage as we work our way through it this morning. Let me pray before we do that. Heavenly Father, our prayer this morning is that you would speak to us through your word, and that by it indeed we might have hope in our Lord Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen. Well, here we are in Christmas season, if you didn't know already. In fact, if you're a 12 days of Christmas countdown sort of person, today is the day you can kick it off. 12 days to Christmas by my count, and only 11 of them are shopping days. It does, of course, also, as Gary said, mark the launch of our pre-Christmas mini-series that we've called, in a slightly tongue-in-cheek way, The Big Words of Christmas. We've got two Sundays and then Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, looking at three of the biggest words of the season. Not, as someone suggested to me the other day, the sort of big theological words that Bible college students enjoy, like incarnation or parthenogenesis. Have you heard that one? You can look it up later. Not even big Christmas words like PlayStation. But the biggest, most significant and most enduring Christmas card words like hope and joy and peace. They are not necessarily the Christmas words with the most letters, but But they are the Christmas words with the most significance, especially, I think, if you haven't got them. Today's big word is hope. It's only four letters long, but maybe you know in your own life only too well. When it seems like there is no hope, then nothing else seems to really matter, does it? It's maybe in that way that the biggest word of them all is hope. There is the old saying, of course, where there's life, there's hope. But really, for so many people, it seems just the opposite, doesn't it? Where there is no hope, it sometimes seems there's almost no reason to keep on living. It is, in fact, one of the classic signs of depression, which is sometimes defined as a persistent feeling of hopelessness. Why even bother getting up in the morning? Why even bother going to work? Why bother paying the bills? Because there's no hope that anything's ever going to get any better. Optimism is extinguished, just a persistent sadness. Now, if you've lived with that kind of depression, either in yourself or if you've seen it closely in a family member, you will know that feeling of no hope only too well. And it compounds itself in all kinds of ways. Hope is fundamentally important. Before we go any further, I want to have a shot at a definition, a working biblical definition, in a sense, of what hope actually is. Here is my first attempt. You can argue with me later. But how about this? Hope is a willingness to keep waiting until things are put right. Now, on the other hand, the Merriam-Webster dictionary puts it this way. Hope is to desire with expectation of attainment. Now, that's true enough, isn't it? Not just desiring, but desiring with an expectation that you'll get it. And, of course, when depression kicks in, that's when you realise there's no reasonable expectation of attainment at all, or so it seems. And hope then just becomes wishful thinking because you feel there's nothing you or anyone else can do to obtain your deepest desires. And so you are no longer, you see, willing to keep waiting until things are put right, because you're convinced they won't be and they can't be and they never will be, full stop. Now, you might notice that first definition of hope on the screen there is kind of different. That is a kind of a rough biblical definition, I'm suggesting, because ultimately in that definition, the expectation is personal and it's based on a conviction that there is a trustworthy hand at work behind circumstances that is working for good and not evil and will ultimately somehow put everything that's wrong right again. Now, of course, sometimes that gets challenged too, and if you're struggling with depression or doubt, even as a Christian, you're going to have problems with that, which is why depression and doubt are so often linked. But can I say at the very least this morning, it is a picture of Israel's hope in the late stages of the Old Testament. Because for the nation of Israel, the whole nation, circumstances are dire. By the time in the Old Testament you get to the second half of the book of the prophet Isaiah, Israel has been smashed as a nation and taken into exile. Back home, there is nothing left but Jerusalem as a pile of rubble. I was reading an article the other day about a young Iraqi man. He has come back to his hometown that last year was overrun by ISIL. Now it's just a ruin. He says not only that, they have left landmines and improvised bombs everywhere. He says, you go to your old neighbourhood, you find your old house, you walk in, you open the door of the fridge, and it's likely to blow up on you. They've set a bomb in it. And you know, God says to Israel in almost exactly those circumstances through the prophet Isaiah, you know what, after all that, it is time for comfort. It is time for hope again, because I am going to turn things round. Take a look at these words. They'll come up on the screen, Isaiah chapter 40. God says, comfort, comfort my people. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem. Proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. or just a couple of chapters later in Isaiah 42, because God says his plan is to send his servant, who's not going to stop at just bringing justice to Israel again, but to the rest of us as well. This is a big plan, a big promise for an astonishing turnaround from Israel as a crushed pile of rubble to the centerpiece of God's plans for the world. God says this, my servant, my chosen one, it's Isaiah 42, we better click now, Bob, please. He will bring justice to the nations, not just Israel. And everyone else will have hope as well. Read the words on the screen, this coming one, he says, he will not falter or be discouraged till he establishes justice on earth. In his teaching, the islands will put their hope. The islands, you see, being all the surrounding nations as far as your ships can sail. Not just comfort for Jerusalem, but a hope that one day all kinds of people will put their trust in this one to come and find hope. Now, the trouble is, nothing seems to happen. Isaiah says those words, he tells everyone, but nothing seems to happen. Israel's exile in Babylon just keeps going on and on and on, 70 years. And then when the decree comes that they can leave and go home, most just decide to stay. The kebabs are better in Babylon, besides which you could eat bacon there. Some come back. They're struggling. They're struggling to build a new temple, struggling to build a new wall, struggling just to keep hoping, struggling to keep waiting for God to one day put things right for Israel and for the world. To keep waiting for that promised servant, Israel's Redeemer, who was going to fix things. They have been waiting for so long it seems hopeless. Who would still be waiting in the expectation that God would somehow put things right after hundreds and hundreds of years? Who'd be that crazy? Well, it's at that point that Luke picks up the threads of that long story and draws them together in the birth of this baby named Jesus. And I want to introduce you now to two people who are that crazy to still be hoping. First of all, an old guy named Simeon. We read about him in the passage. The scene unfolds in the temple where Joseph and Mary are bringing Jesus to consecrate him to the Lord as their firstborn son and to offer the sacrifices that are set out in the Old Testament law. Luke 2 verse 24 says a pair of doves or two young pigeons, which is what, if you look back in the Old Testament law in Leviticus chapter 12, is the offering you're told to bring if you can't afford to bring a lamb. These folks are dirt poor. And this is a humble ceremony, maybe a few friends gathered as well. But Luke records that apart from his mum and dad, there is one old guy in Jerusalem that the Spirit has somehow prompted that morning to come up to the temple, an old Israelite who was still hoping. Now remember, hope is a willingness to keep waiting until things are put right. Read what Luke says there in verse 25. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. All this time, still waiting for the comfort of Israel, the consolation Isaiah promised hundreds of years before, through all the ups and downs. And God has given this Simeon a special insight that it's all going to happen in his lifetime, that he personally would be there to see the promised one, to see the fulfillment of his hope. Luke says in verse 26, it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. And Simeon, he's at the temple, he spots him straight away and he picks him up in his arms and he praises God, saying in verse 29, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. I can die happy. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. He'd been willing to keep waiting. He'd been hoping for the consolation of Israel. Now the time has come for things to be put right. Now there's a woman in the temple too, the day Joseph and Mary bring their baby for dedication. Her name's Anna, and we're told there in verse 36 that she is very old. It's one of those tragic stories. She'd been married only 7 years when she tragically lost her husband. And she's been a widow ever since. Now she's 84 years old. One of those faithful women who, it seems, never leaves the temple. Absolutely faithful Israelite, temple worship, fasting, praying day and night. And that very same moment, she comes up to them, their little group, and verse 38 says, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. So it seems like there are others she's talking to who have been holding out hope as well, who have been looking forward to that time that God was going to put things right for his people, waiting for so long, hoping, waiting for God to comfort his people, restore Jerusalem to glory as the centre of the world by sending the Messiah, the Redeemer, who is going to somehow buy back their freedom. Might have struck them as just a little bit odd, though, if they'd noticed before that his mum and dad had offered just a bird or two as a sacrifice because they couldn't afford a lamb. That's not very fitting for a Messiah. Might have struck them as even more odd if they'd been there a little bit earlier in the chapter for his birth and seen him wrapped in rags in a barn. It's not very royal for a coming king. I remember once years ago, Ray Martin did a story on a young single mum who was so poor that a baby had to sleep in the box the DVD player came in. They call that poor. Joseph and Mary had to improvise with a feed trough. Now, it might have struck those same people as even more odd years later. Because as you follow through Luke's gospel account, you can watch while Jesus develops a huge reputation. And on one level, he's doing everything you'd expect a Messiah to do. I mean, he's healing people, he's giving the blind their sight, he's making crippled people walk, he's walking on water, he's calming storms, multiplying bread without a Brumby's bakery anywhere in sight. But on another level, there's opposition as well, and it's growing. And it's opposition from high places, to the point where the long-awaited hope of Israel seems hopeless. Remember the barbed edge in Simeon's words? There are sad times ahead, testing times. And in the end, they take him and they crucify him and he is dead, and it seems all hope is lost. I mean, what do you say to the hopers when it seems so hopeless? Sometimes it does seem like the pessimists are always right, doesn't it? Jesus is hanging there on a Roman cross. He has been executed like every other potential Messiah who ever staked a claim against the Romans and tried to bring back the glory days of Israel. He started out so well. It was all so hopeful. He was the one that Simeon hoped would be the consolation of Israel, the one who Anna dared hope would be the redemption of Jerusalem. And now he's lying cold and dead in a tomb, hopeless. Now look, I mentioned we are following through the theme of hope here in Luke's gospel, and it's at that point that an interesting thing happens. It's late in the afternoon on the Sunday. He's been dead in the tomb since the Friday. And two of his followers, not from the closest 12, but they'd been sort of on the edge of things. One of them's a guy called Cleopas. And they're heading out of Jerusalem on a 10 or 11K walk to the village of Emmaus in the dusk. And they're talking over what's happened, and they're full of disappointment. Another guy joins them on the road, a shadowy figure, and he asks them on the road in the twilight, "What are you talking about, guys?" And Cleopas says to him, "Are you the only one in town who doesn't know what's been happening? Everyone's been talking about it." "What things?" "About Jesus of Nazareth," says Cleopas. And he tells the stranger what's happened and how he was a powerful prophet who did powerful things and spoke powerful words. But he says the chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death and they crucified him. Here are the key words, Luke chapter 24, verse 21. I'll put them on the screen. "But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel." We had hoped. They crucified him. We had hoped for a while, but now the hope's gone. extinguished by the disappointment of death, as hope so often is. I mean, that's what it is, isn't it, death, that makes everything so often seem so hopeless. Lou and I went to a funeral last Wednesday at a crematorium. Sudden death, mid-50s, a bereft wife who spoke powerfully of the way he had made her a better person, the way he'd made her laugh. Both of them staunchly and resolutely atheists. At the end, she said, "Now he's gone. What's to be done? What's to be done?" It's hard to answer, isn't it? Just so sad, seemed so hopeless, because there was no prospect of anything more. That was it. What was to be done? But look, as Luke tells his story, it is at this point that everything changes. Because the fact is, the shadowy figure walking unrecognised with Cleopas and his mate on the road, it is the last person in the world they're expecting, because Luke says it is Jesus himself, alive on the other side of his execution. And when they finally recognise him, of course, everything changes. And they come to realise that what they had hoped for has already happened. That he has redeemed Israel and others as well. Because you see, in his condemnation and his innocent death, he was taking on himself all the condemnation due not just to Israel, but the rest of us as well. Taking the curse of the law on himself. Paul says later in the New Testament, taking the curse on himself so nobody else has to. He has done it on the cross. That was the redemption. When Jesus started out in a backyard cowshed, people were hopeful, but they didn't really realise the scope of the project he was working on. He wasn't just going to redeem Israel and console a few Israelites. He was going to die and rise again in a way that brings forgiveness and the hope of new life for all of us. Can I finish with a word to any of you here this morning who feel that you have lost hope? Maybe it has gone so far for you that you are clinically depressed, and you do need to be getting help for that, and I urge you to do that. But at the same time, please remember that the resurrection of Jesus teaches us that no matter how dire things look along the way, that the end is not death and futility, but life and purpose. Even if you can't see it right now. The resurrection teaches us that pessimism doesn't have the last word, but that there is every reason for optimism, even if you don't feel it right now. The resurrection teaches us to take the long view on God keeping his promises, and that his promises are worth holding on to no matter what your current circumstances or how much you are tempted to give up right now. Because of Jesus, we have hope in the face of every disappointment. Because we know that every setback is only ever temporary. It's hope in the face of grief, because we know even death itself didn't hold him down. Hope is one of the big words of Christmas, and it's a big word for every other season as well. Later on, the disciple Peter puts it this way in a letter to a bunch of Christians who are doing it very tough. Great words to close with this morning as we patiently keep our hope in what lies ahead. Peter says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil or fade. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials." Gary's going to lead us in prayer, then we're going to share in the Lord's Supper together.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this reminder today that this Christian hope is not a maybe kind of hope. It's not an if things go well kind of hope. But it's a small word with great significance. A hope that doesn't disappoint, a hope that delivers, a hope that is living, Your word tells us it's a hope that has its basis in Jesus, our risen and living Saviour. Father, we thank you and we praise you that this hope doesn't rely on the circumstances of our life remaining positive. We look at people like Anna and Simeon who believe the Saviour will come despite their past and present circumstances. We remember people like the Apostle Paul and people that the Apostle Peter wrote about, who despite their trials and their persecution, believe that Jesus will return. And Father, we pray the day that despite where we might be in life, that you would fill us with this same expectant and unfailing hope, hope that flows to us through Jesus, from Jesus and through your Spirit. We pray that you would fill us with this hope today. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.